everybody. Welcome to episode 2 of the Fight House podcast. We have a great lineup for you tonight. We're going to start off with Emmanuel Sanchez from Bellator coming off a big win against Marcos Galvao. Then we're going to come up with lightweight title contender Brent Primus, Steve Cazola, who's got a couple things to say to Mr. Dylan Danis. Don Pallarte, he's coming off a big win at LFA 7 over Adrian Yanez. We're going to close out the show with Steven Peterson. So get ready and hold on. It's going to be a good night. Let's go. We'll be right back with Emmanuel Sanchez.
Keeping the range, throwing everything but the kitchen sink at Marcos Galvao. It went all 15 minutes with this fight. Clear dominance for Emmanuel Sanchez.
What's going on, everybody? We're back. We have Emmanuel Sanchez on the line. How's it going, Emmanuel? How's everything?
Doing good. Thank you very much.
Coming off a big win, man. It's a big fight against Marcos Galvao.
Yeah, just soaking it all in. It's very good, but still more to learn and work on. So just getting ready for the next.
How did you feel about your performance in the fight? Did you feel like you executed the way you wanted to?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, tough takedowns, and, you know, if you think about it, the way I outclassed him earlier, that's kind of my way of sprawling brawl, you know? Only I'm not brawling, I'm just outclassing someone on the feet. You know, I beat him everywhere.
You did a really great job, I noticed, of ending your combinations with kicks and kind of keeping them out of range. Was that part of the game plan?
I'd say, yeah, kicking a lot. It's just, it's in my it's repertoire of fighting, you know? I just come from a mixed martial arts gym, but, you know, my instructor was a striking legend.
Absolutely.
You know, that's what he's known for, and that's just what he teaches us every day. It's not just one form of striking either, you know. I'm not just Muay Thai. I'm not kickboxing. I'm everything, you know. I'm Taekwondo, karate, capoeira, Kyushin, Dutch style kickboxing, you know. I'm mixing it all together.
Yeah, man, you definitely look crisp on the feet. Everything seemed to come together for you, man. It was a really, really solid performance. One thing I noticed, so you had an issue with the weight. I know when we talked before the fight, I know you were saying you were battling some injuries. Did that have anything to do with you, your inability to make the weight?
No, not at all. It was actually more stress than anything. I was so stressed leading up to the fight, and it was just so much stress of just life and other, you know, areas of my life. And leading up to the week of the fight, I was stress-free because weight didn't become an issue anymore. You know, I got overconfident. I got cocky, actually. And obviously it's harder as you get older. And as I was going on through fight week, it wasn't a matter of I can't lose anymore. It was a matter of time. You know, and now with earlier weigh-ins and only having a two-hour window, you can't waste time when it comes to it. And the times, you know, I went to bed, 4 pounds over. And 4 pounds is like nothing, you know what I mean? That sounds like nothing. And woke up earlier, started to, do what I needed to do to get it off. And what I was doing didn't make me lose a pound, not one pound. And As it came rolling around 9 o'clock, that was about the time we needed to go to the athletic club and start to try to lose more. And of course, trying to lose, not even that much, but trying to lose any weight in such a short amount of time is, you know, it's hard because it takes time. And so I wasted time, and that's all my fault. You know, I just gotta learn and be better from it. And I mean, not at one point did I feel lightheaded. I didn't feel sick, nothing. It wasn't a matter of not getting out. It was just a matter of time, and it sucks because it cost me
20%. Right? That's what the fee is, right? Correct.
Yep.
Oh, yikes! That sucks. So what is it that you took from it? Was it just something you're going to do a little bit differently the next time, or is it just like basically like, you know, don't get so cocky and stay on top of it and just get to work?
Well, of course, there's obviously, which I normally already do in training anyways, not getting heavy in between fights. You know, I don't get over 20 pounds my weight. There's also the fact of the matter of just getting started ahead of time too. Of course, like I said, as you get older, it gets harder. So it's not like we're just dropping 5 pounds of workout every time I work out and train, it's something that happens gradually. And, yeah, because when I was younger, yeah, you know what I mean? It's easier. You go out and do something and you just, oh, hey, yeah, you lost that pound. Wow, you made weight. Yeah, easy. Wow. Damn, you know, with one workout or one thing. And now, you know, that's not the case anymore. You do something, you know, it only is one or two, you know, especially as you get down to the last, you know, seven. Yeah, when you get down to the last seven, you know, yeah, that's when it gets, you know, you got to work a little harder and then do more gradually to be able to get the weight off. But the goal is always, you know, on some of the best cuts that I had and best performances I had, I woke up on weight. And I even ate dinner or I had breakfast, you know, before I even had to go in. And, you know, I wasn't dehydrated at all. So I know it's possible. It's not like, you know, I can't do it anymore. No, it's just I just messed up big time. And, yeah, it cost me.
You know, but when we talked before the fight, you were saying that, like, you were bothered and hindered by some injuries that you had never given a chance to fully heal. Are you able to talk more about those now that the fight's over? I know you obviously didn't want to talk about them going into the fight, but what exactly was bothering you? What was the issue?
Oh, yeah, I still have it. Fractured hand, slightly torn ligaments. Yeah, I got a lot of stuff wrong with me, but I still just keep pushing through it. So, I mean, yeah, you know, I just got to let myself heal and work. But, yeah, that's what I got right now is just my weapons, man. You know, that's why you still haven't seen the best of me yet. I still got to recover a little bit more and get myself better. But, yeah, I've had a bad hand for quite a while now. And I'm not going to say a bad leg because I can still kick. But, yeah, I've had some issues with the knee and hand issues. That's what I've had. And it just goes to I just got to take care of myself. And, you know, we got to train around it, really. You know, I'm not going to just not train or I don't need surgery. Nothing's broken. And if it's not broke, don't fix it. So, you know, I just need to, you know, be a little more therapeutic and let myself heal and recover.
You had a solid performance, maybe even one of the best performances of your career. Did you feel that was your best performance? Like, or you were at your best at the moment? Or is there still a better Manuel Sanchez to come? Or were you not at your peak?
Yeah, you know, I feel like the best is still yet to come. Mm-hmm. I feel like... I'm very pleased in the sense that, you know, I had such a diverse striking attack, you know. It's not like I was just boxing, I was just kicking, or I was, you know what I mean? I did a lot of stuff that I, you know, I impressed myself, I guess. You know what I mean? So small victories, one step at a time. But obviously these guys are still standing. I know the lighter the weight classes go, it's harder to knock guys out. So people criticize me and judge me, I guess, in that sense of saying, oh, he's got a lot of ring time being a young fighter and this and that. Well, believe it or not, I still have never broken any of my weapons. I've never been hurt by any of these guys. And, yeah, after the fight, just the usual soreness, but I take care of myself. So, you know, okay, yeah, I fought a lot of rounds and fought a lot of guys in, you know, this past 2-3 years, but none of them had hurt me. So, yeah, I mean, I'm good, you know. The worst thing I've suffered is headbutts, and that really pissed me off. But, I mean, the fact that, yeah, a lot of these guys, I know I can finish them, so I just can't continue to put pressure on myself like that. And just go out and have fun. I fight my fight, and I do my thing. And, all right, man, you know, it's tough to knock guys out. It's tough to finish guys. These are the best guys in the world. You know what I mean? These are the most experienced guys in the world with the most fights, you know. And, you know, yeah, I mean, of course, you want to knock everybody out and choke everybody out. That's just not the case. So
gets a lot harder to do once you move up the
ranks. It is what it is. You got to take it with a grain of salt, I guess. But, you know, on to the next one. I'm just getting better. I'm only getting better, and I know it's coming. And, yeah, I guess that's the biggest thing. You know, I want to go out and leave no doubt, I guess, because all these guys and people want to leave it up and criticize and say, you know, dumb things. But if it's they're not getting knocked out, then I'm beating them up for 3 rounds. Because each and every one of these guys, you know, I'm sure they remember me. That's for sure.
You know, before, again, we spoke before the fight, and you were saying that you weren't sure if you were going to take a vacation, heal up, if you were going to jump right back in and start training again for the next fight. Because I know you wanted to be very active this year after being forced onto the sideline for a little bit. You have any idea what you want to do? Is it going to be a little bit of rest time, or what's your plan?
Man, I'm really messed up in the head, you know what I mean? Like, part of me is like, yeah, you know, I was thinking as I was getting ready for this guy and then having just beaten Georgie, I'm just like, man, I need a vacation. I need a rest. I need to do this. And I now, you know, and then I fight this guy. That's what I was saying, you know, and thinking like, man, after this, I need to, you know, I need to take a break. But I don't feel that way at all. You know, right now, I feel like I need to redeem myself because people, you know, of course, like I said, I don't let any of it get to me. I know it sounds like it. I am or I have let it get to me, but I guess, you know, I still obviously have more to prove. So I just want to shut all these naysayers up and then, you know, obviously just do something fantastic and amazing. You know what I mean? To get things you ever had, you got to do things you've never done. So, yeah, I mean, when I say that, you know what I mean? That there's records to break, money to make, and this whole game to take. So that's what I want to do. I want to go out and I want to be the most active guy in the roster, which I feel like I have been already in this division, you know, compared to every other guy who's been at the top right now. And, yeah, man, go out for fight, you know, and let's go out for 5 wins this year undefeated and get that belt.
You know, saying that you want to jump back in, would you like to find yourself, if you, is it even possible for you to find yourself onto the 180 card in New York? Is that something that you're going to look into or you would hope for? Or? Hello?
I'm sorry. I can't hear you that well.
Sorry. I said, like looking to get right back into things and looking to be extremely active. Would 180 be an option for you, Bellator 180 in New York? Is that something you're going to talk to someone about or try to pull off, or how do you feel about that card, trying to get on that card?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. You know, I mean, it's hard to tell with what they're going to do with a lot of guys. You know what I mean? Like, I saw McKee just got an opponent. Mm-hmm. Gallagher's fighting Machida, which I know is going to be a tough fight, but I think it's going to be a good one. But you know what? Regardless, I'll stay ready. You know what? Like, I mean, if anyone pulls out, if anything happens, you know, that's the way I see it, is that it's always going to be an opportunity to happen. Like, we can never think that, oh, they're not going to get injured or nothing's going to, you know, that's not going to happen. I mean, stuff happens. Or maybe they fight injured, too. They don't even pull out. You know what I mean? Stuff happens, man. You know, fights get scheduled and get promoted. And, you know, I've, man, what, 2015, I took 2 unscheduled fights. So, you know, I remember when John Teixeira was scheduled to fight Pitbull and Henry Corrales stepped in. I actually got the phone call before that, too. But I was in Las Vegas with my teammate, you know, getting ready for his fight. So, you know, there's the opportunity that, you know, where someone, you know, may pull out is always there. So I'll stay ready in case they, you know, they need somebody. Because not only to, okay, yeah, obviously stay active, fight, go out and win, but beat someone out in Madison Square Garden, you know, the opportunity to be on that card.
Sure.
I think that'd be huge. And, of course, people were, you know, chomping at the bit to get on that card. But I, you know, obviously I'm not going to beg for it. I know I've just been on 2 of the biggest cards already, and we're only, you know, 4 months into the year.
Absolutely.
But, yeah, that's definitely, you know, that's something that's on my radar if an opportunity comes up. So I got to stay ready in case that comes up. And we'll see. We'll see if they give me the winner of Strauss or Pitbull, you know what I mean, up in that title. Or if it takes one more, it takes one more. You know, for me, it's just another name on the hit list, and then one, obviously, for sure, 1 step there, and then we go out and take care of business.
You know, I know you're not a guy that's big on, you know, the talking and the trash talking and all that on social media and stuff like that. I know that's not really your thing. With so many guys content to do that, though, do you have a name on your list that you're like, you know what, I need a big name. I need to make a statement. I don't want to trash talk, but I want to make a point here. Is there a name on your tongue, a guy that you'd like to get in there with and prove a point, somebody with some value?
Just everybody in the division, man. I mean, everyone in the division. I mean, we're all human beings. We all got families. We all got, you know, mouths to feed or ourselves to feed. You know, we provide for ourselves. So,
True. You
know, I'd like to say we're all friends. And, of course, you know, we want everyone to win. But at the end of the day, you guys are all my enemies. You know, I got to fight all you guys. You're all trying to hurt me. All these guys want to knock me out, submit me, you know, cause me some serious physical harm. So, yeah, you're kind of my enemy.
Sure.
So, everyone in the division, man, you know, short or tall, big or small, they all will fall. I want to prove, I'm out to prove that I'm the best. You know, I want to prove that you're the best. You got to fight and beat everybody, you know. So, the division, man, the division, there's no one in particular where I don't want to just beat one guy and think I'm the best already. I got to beat them all.
You know,
so I want to go out and come out on top of them, on all of them, you know,
sure.
Former champion of Bellator or a former UFC, whoever they are, wherever they are, whoever, whenever, whatever, wherever, man, that's what I want.
You know, if you honestly assess the situation, how far do you feel you are away from a title shot? Like, where do you feel like you, if you honestly assess it, where do you feel like you're at?
I most definitely feel like I'm right there, because how can they deny me that, you know? I fought Georgie Karakanyan, who was scheduled to fight for the title before he got hurt. I fought Pat Kern, my third fight in Bellator, you know, on short notice. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Who's got more fights in Bellator than I had professional fights, you know, at the time, you know, on short notice. The former champion of my division. I fought Daniel Vaitchel, who fought for the title, who could be the champion, you know what I mean, if it weren't for one punch by Pitbull. So, you know, and now I just fought Marcos Laura Galvao. And, yeah, man, you can't deny me that I'm right up there. And everyone knows that. The world knows that. You know what I mean? So that's why I feel I don't need to talk my way up there or get on Twitter and Instagram like most guys. I promote myself by putting on the most exciting fights, dominating performances, beating people decisively, and let that speak for itself, because everyone knows my list of opponents for the past 3 years have been guys with twice as much experience, former champions from other organizations, if not, you know, Bellator. And, yeah, man, the toughest fighters in the world.
You know, after your last performance against Marcos, you had like an explosion of emotion almost at the end of the fight. What were you feeling when the fight ended? Was it like, can you describe what the feeling was for you when the fight ended? You kind of knew you had it.
I'm sorry, I can't hear you again, brother.
I apologize. I was saying at the end of the last fight you had with Marcos, you had kind of like a real emotional release, like, you know, like explosion almost of emotion. What were you feeling at the end of the fight when you realized you had it?
Oh, I'm just soaking up, living in the moment, man. You know, just living in the moment. You know, it's when it's time to shine, be the brightest. So I guess the best way I can put it is, like, in any interview or any fight, you know, while all eyes are on you, do what you want. You know, I mean, how are people going to remember you? Like, I lost. I'm 26 years old. I've been dreaming about this since I was 18, you know what I mean, 17. Like, I've been watching these guys, all these legends, fight in front of me, you know, and I've been that kid, you know, and now I'm living out my dream, you know. Like, I'm fighting in front of Fedor, in front of Tito, in front of Vanderlei. I'm fighting on the same card as Tito, as Chael, you know, as Hoist Gracie. Like, what other young kid right now is doing it but me, you know? It's like, I'm just living in the moment. I'm soaking it all up, you know. Now it's not like, hey, you know, I am or was a fan of these guys. Like, these guys are fans of me now, because now they're watching me fight.
You know, one thing, speaking of legends that we spoke about before, is you were super excited to fight on a card with Rampage. You had said it was the first pay-per-view you bought with your own money was Rampage Jackson. How did it feel to compete on the card when it was all said and done with Rampage?
I'm sorry, if what?
If to compete on the card with Rampage Jackson, like, how did that feel? Because I know that you you had said that it was important to you. You know, it was the first pay-per-view you bought with your own money. What was that like to compete with Rampage on the same card?
Oh, that was just nuts, man. Yeah, because as I was just telling you, I was 17. Yeah, I was like 17, 18 years old.
Mm-hmm.
And I had watched the full season of The Ultimate Fighter in that year. You know what I mean? That's, you know, when MMA was getting kind of big.
Absolutely.
And, yeah, I'd watched that whole full season. Like, I didn't miss one episode. You know, I made sure I watched that whole full season against him versus Forrest. And then that summer I bought that pay-per-view. And he lost, but, I mean, it was just like thinking, like, wow, I've seen this guy fight, you know, I've bought this so many pay-per-views that this guy's been on, you know, and that was the first that I bought, but I, you know, gotten so many that he had been on, you know, and it's just, like, crazy to think, like, damn, I'm co-main event next to this guy, you know what I mean? It's just, it's like, wow, you can't write a better story, it's, you know?
Absolutely. Listen, man, I want to thank you for coming on and taking a couple minutes to talk with us. I really appreciate it, and it was a great fight, man, super entertaining, and I hope to see you back in the cage sooner than later.
Thank you so much for the time and the interview. I appreciate it very much.
Absolutely, man. Thanks again, and have a good night, bud. Talk to you soon.
Thank you, too. Talk to you soon.
All right, man.
Bye-bye.
That was Emmanuel Sanchez, man. Great guy, great fight. You know, I always enjoy talking to him. And hopefully we see him in the octagon with a big fight coming up soon. We'll be right back after this with Brent Primus, and we'll talk about his upcoming title fight with Michael Chandler. Tune in.
End of the fight.
Brent Primus finally getting the takedown, landing a nice right hand, finally getting his ground and pound going. We thought it was too little, too late. The judges did not agree.
Hey, we're back, and we got Brent Primus on the line, Bellator lightweight title contender from Madison Square Garden at Bellator 180. How's it going, Brent? Thanks for coming on to the show.
Yeah, it's going good. Thanks for having me.
Good, good, man. First of all, I was on your Facebook, man. It seems like there's a congratulations in order, if I am correct. Is it true that you're expecting a little one, yeah?
Yeah, like March 14th is the due date. It's going to be a boy, so yeah, pretty excited. And yeah, it's pretty awesome. Can't wait.
Yeah, man, that is pretty exciting. Good for you, man. I'm really happy for you guys.
Thank you.
Get into this fight stuff, man. This is a big time period for you, man. A lot of things going on this spring and summer.
Yeah, definitely. Pretty much the biggest opportunity in my life here in, a little under 3 months, and the fun begins right now. And I'm just training my butt off, getting ready for June 24th.
Man, there's a lot that's gone on before this, though. A lot of people may not know. You were actually supposed to fight Adam Piccolotti, and things got canceled in February, correct?
Yeah.
And then after that, you had another opponent for early in March, and something happened with that.
And then he got injured too. Yeah, they were both top 10 lightweights, and so that was just a whirlwind, training camps. I went through a full training camp, and, mentally and physically and financially, it's pretty hard to do. And it was really hard, but, everything happens for a reason, and, Piccolotti got hurt, and I got a title shot, so it all worked out.
Yeah, man. What were you feeling like, though? What was the emotions like when especially now that you have a baby coming, you got things are happening in your family, and it's like you're spending money on these camps and the fight gets canceled. Then, you're getting ready for another fight. That gets canceled, and your time's getting put in and your money's getting put in. Like, how frustrating was that for you?
It was really frustrating, man. Just financially, my conditioning coaches, my coaches, and just all the money, eating healthy, and it took a toll, and I was definitely struggling, and I was just about to call my grandpa, see if I can walk for him or do something, it was definitely a hard time for sure. I was I just literally went through like a 2-month training camp, just killed myself, and I got my weight down in 2 pounds of cutting, and I was definitely ready to get in that cage. And then not only that was going to be on the first Fedor card, but Matt got sick.
Yeah.
And so it kind of all worked out, So now I'm on the Madison Square Garden fighting on the same card as Fedor Emelianenko and Evander and Chael and Douglas Lima, and I'm fighting for the world title. This is a dream come true. All that hard work is paying off. So it's pretty exciting and pretty awesome.
What's it like to compete with those guys on the same card as guys that are just legends in the sport you probably came up watching? So what's that like for you?
It's crazy. It's a humongous honor, and I feel so blessed. Like you said, I used to order the Pride fights back in the day, and Wanderlei Silva and Fedor Emelianenko were like my favorite fighters ever. I used to love watching them, and to be fighting in the same card as them is like unreal. It's literally a dream come true. It's pretty cool, man. I'm pretty excited about this whole thing, and I still got a lot of work ahead of me right now, and so that's what I'm focusing on, Chandler, and every minute of the day, pretty much just thinking about Chandler and getting in there and getting the job done.
You're speaking about Fedor and Wanderlei and guys like this. Have you had a chance to communicate with those guys? What's it like to brush elbows with those guys backstage after being a fan of them for so long?
Pretty much, Fedor is kind of a silent, deadly man. He didn't really say too much. I said hi to him, and he just gave me a little nod. I wanted to get a picture taken with him, but I didn't want to be one of those little fanboys. But, it's cool just being in the same room as that guy. He's literally just pretty silent, doesn't really say too much. And Wanderlei, I've met Wanderlei a couple of times. Wanderlei is pretty cool, man. He's an awesome guy. And, Matt Matrone is the coolest dude ever. And Chael Sonnen, I trained with Chael up in Portland at Gracie Baja with Fabiano Scherner and those guys. And Chael's the coolest dude in the world, too. So, man, it's awesome to train with all these legends for sure. Or fighting the same cards on it, at least.
You know, What was the moment like when you realized, when you found out you were going to get the title fight? Like, after all the trials and tribulations of having fights canceled and going through camps and suffering financially, going through the periodization process of getting, like, peaking for the fight and it not happening. After all that was said and done, and you found out you're getting the, you're going to end up getting a title shot out of it. What was that like emotionally for you?
It's hard to describe. You know, it's man, I literally could not believe it. It took me a few days to actually let it settle in and be like, man, I really am fighting for the lightweight title. Like, it took a while. It really did. And it really didn't all sink in 100% until I went to New York and did face off with Chandler and did all the media and the press conferences. And that's when it really sunk in, you know. And then I was just, man, I just can't wait to get home and start training for this guy. And, but that's when it really sunk in. And like I said, man, it took a few days for it to for me to actually like realize. I had to pinch myself a couple times every morning I woke up and just really, was that a dream or no, it's not. Dang, I really am fighting for the belt, you know? So yeah, it's cool, man. And it's going to be an honor to get in there and get war, you know, go to war with Chandler. It's going to be awesome.
You know, what's the pressure like? This is a change. I mean, you're going from Adam Piccolotti to Michael Chandler. This is a huge change in the level of competition and the stage, the size of the stage. Like, you're going to be at Madison Square Garden, probably the most iconic building for combat sports in history. What's that like for you, man? Just what's that do for your nerves and stuff like that, just to have that kind of contrast?
You know, it's I don't know. I'm trying to not really think about all that stuff, you know. Like, I got a humongous task in front of me. So this sport is like, it's a mental sport. And so, you know, I'm just going to grind through this camp. And one of the things that makes me, you know, feel comfortable walking in that cage, getting ready for war, is just how I train. You know, I train really, really hard. Every day I put everything into it. And, you know, I train like a savage, you know, so that's just one of the reasons that makes me get in there and, you know, feel comfortable getting in there and, throwing down with, you know, some of the best lightweights in the world is, just my training, how I work. You know, I have a crazy work ethic and, you know, I'm, going to show that on the 24th for sure.
What did it feel like when you were face to face with Chandler for the first time and you looked at him? Did you get any vibe off, any energy off him? Did you see anything? Like, what was the stare down like the first time?
You know,
time you guys...
not really too much. Just the butterflies, how exciting it, you know, it is, and how surreal it is. You know, like, but you know, Chandler's a true champion. You know, he's an awesome fighter. He goes in there and goes to war. And man, I'm so excited that I actually get to go in there and fight a true champion. You know, you want to be the best fighters, you got to fight the best fighters, and that's what I'm going to do, and that's what I'm doing. And I'm just really excited that I'm on a big stage. I'm going to go out there and throw down. I'm telling you, I'm going to put everything I have into this and come out there with that belt.
You know, one of the things, as soon as this fight was announced, I was talking with a buddy of mine about it, and I said, like, this has such a Weidman versus Silva feel to it. Like, you have this super experienced longtime champion, and then this undefeated up and comer coming up that no one, you know, you're a huge underdog,
like
the betting lines and stuff, right? And like, I'm reading articles where people are already talking about, like, you know, is Scott Coker going to get more strong challengers for Chandler after the fight? And it's like, it almost seems like there's a lot of people that are completely looking past the fact that you could win this title. Does it take a little bit of pressure off you?
Yeah, you know, like I said, I feel like most of the pressure's on Chandler. You know, like, he's the champion, blah blah. You know, I feel like I usually am going in there with, like, man, I feel like the whole world is on my shoulders. Like, I'm going in there, I'm like, man, no matter what, I gotta win, no matter what. And that's how I am right now too. But I just feel like most of the pressure's on him. I like being the underdog. This is awesome. Man, I can't remember the last time I had been the underdog, but I just, it's a good thing being the underdog. You know, it drives me, it makes me train harder. Ever since I was little, you know, my mom or anybody would tell me, you can't do this, it's impossible. Like, man, I just would, I would make it sure that I'd just do anything I could to prove them wrong, you know? So, and this is just a big showcase of that. I'm just going to go out there and prove everybody wrong. And I love being the underdog, and I thrive off of it. You know, it makes me train harder, and man, and I'm training hard right now, and I still got 3 months out. So, you know, I'm going to be ready for war. If I don't knock him out or choke him out in the first round, man, I'm going to be ready for a 5-round, awesome, exciting, bloody battle. And, you know, so stay tuned.
Do you feel like this is going to be like your coming out party? This is going to be when people really realize like what level you're really at?
Yeah, I think so, 100%. You know, one thing that Chandler, you know, he's had a lot of experience. He's had many 5-round battles in there, you know, and so I think that everybody's seen his heart. They've seen his game. But, you know, I haven't had that much time in that cage, so a lot of people haven't seen what I can do and haven't seen my stand-up. And, man, I literally have not even came close to what I can do. You know, nobody has seen what I'm capable of. So I'm excited to go in there and shine and just let loose. And, man, I'm going to shock the MMA world, and it's going to be awesome. So it's going to be a big, big night for me, and I'm really excited. I'm excited for all this work that I have, you know, in the next 3 months to put in the head of this guy. And, yeah, man, I can't wait. I'm truly honored to be fighting on this card. It's going to be awesome. I just read today or whatever, yesterday, that we're going to be weighing on the same scale that Muhammad Ali weighed on and, you know, a bunch of guys. So, man, this is just, it's awesome. It's a dream come true.
Definitely, man. It's definitely the grandest stage you could fight on, right?
Yeah, for sure.
Do you feel like the fact that you're going, this is such a huge jump in competition for you, like from what you've been fighting, it's kind of like you're skipping this whole stage of like of the come up, right? Do you feel like that's an advantage to you going there? Like, we've seen Chandler in 5-round wars, like you said, like we've seen him go into that gut check time and over and over again, but no one's really seen you get pushed to that point. Do you feel like that's an advantage for you?
Yeah, I think it's a good thing and a bad thing. You know, I mean, I think having, you know, all that experience is a good thing, but at the same time, man, he's taken a lot of damage to his brain, you know, having all those battles and all those wars, and that stuff takes a toll on you and takes a toll on your chin. And he's had plenty of battles in there. And so that's one thing that, you know, I can say that I haven't had all that those concussions and all that trauma in there. And so that's a good thing. And also, like I said before, you know, not everybody has seen my game. They don't know what I'm capable of. They don't know my combos. They don't know, you know, there's so much that people haven't seen. So it's definitely a good thing. But, you know, it's also good to have, you know, that experience, that all those minutes in the cage, you know, that's good too. Sure. But, you know, it's a good thing and bad thing, I feel.
How do you feel like you match up with Chandler at the end of the day? I think I match up.
Yeah, I think I match up great. You know, like, I think my jiu-jitsu is awesome. You know, I've rolled with, you know, world champs and some of the best guys, some of the best MMA guys. And, you know, my jiu-jitsu feels great against all those guys, you know. So, you know, I definitely feel like my ground game is awesome. And even on the feet, you know, I've been working on some really good stuff for this guy. And I'm going to go to a really solid camp. And, you know, I got a reach on him. And, you know, I feel good with my footwork. Feels really great right now. And, you know, like I said, you know, he doesn't know my game. He doesn't know what I'm going to go out there and do. And he hasn't seen my full potential. So it's going to be a good thing. And I'm going to show everybody on the 24th.
You know, one of the things that, and this is like, we're actually going to be talking about this in a further podcast, more of a bantering podcast. But one thing that's weird to me is that you guys aren't the main event.
Hello?
Hello, are you there?
Yeah.
One of the things that's weird to me is that you guys aren't the main event. Like, I find it a little off that like that title fight of this magnitude, and even the other title fight, the welterweight title fight, isn't headlining the event. Does that seem a little off to you that like the titles, like the promotion's title fights, aren't headlining this event?
You know, I kind of said that at first, and then, you know, I looked at who's fighting in front of me, and that's Vanderlei Silva and Chael Sonnen and Matt Matrone and Fedor Emelianenko. I'm like, man, it'd just be so weird to be fighting, you know, headlining those guys. You know, I think it would be. Those guys are legends. I've looked up to those guys, you know, for a long time. And I feel like if this was on any other card, any one of these fights would be headlining that card. So, honestly, I really don't mind. Actually, I'm kind of cool with it. I'm going to go out there and put a whoop down on Chandler, win that belt, and, you know, shower up and go out and watch, you know, some of these legends fight. So I'm kind of cool with it. And like I said, man, I feel a little bit weird, you know, being the main event over Fedor and those guys. So I'm cool with it for sure.
Because, you know, just from a promotional standpoint, for me, I was just like, you know, I feel like if anytime you have a title fight, that fight should be headlining, you know what I mean? But I definitely understand
for
what you're saying, like being behind those guys. And what do you think about those fights? I guess we should ask you that. What do you think about the Matt Mitrione Fedor fight?
Man, it's gonna be a good fight. Just crazy because I grew up just like idolizing Fedor, man. I thought he was just the man, and
yeah,
it's hard for me to go against him, you know. But Matt Mitrione's a beast in himself, you know. And not only is he a beast, he's an awesome, cool, funny dude, you know. So, man, with that fight, I'm just gonna sit back and watch and enjoy that fight. And then with the Vanderlei and Chael one, you know, I think with the Vanderlei, anything can happen with that guy. But I think Chael has awesome wrestling, and if he uses his wrestling, and I think he can take Vanderlei down, and you know, wrestle him down and wear him out that way. But like I said, with the Vanderlei, you never know for sure. That's the axe murder, and he'll come out swinging for sure.
Yeah, guaranteed. What's it like to sit there and listen to those guys banter back and forth? Like, you're at the press conference, you're kind of sitting there. What was it like to hear Chael and him with their back and forth and Chael's trash talk?
Man, I loved it. You know, that was my first like big press conference, and so I was up there. I don't know if you could tell, but I was up there and I was pretty dang nervous, you know. So I was up there nervous, and as soon as I heard Chael start going off, and man, it just totally relaxed me, and I felt like I was at like a comedy show, and it was hilarious, you know. So I just I enjoyed that, and it's kind of cool, you know. I think there's enough tough guys out there in the sport that just are mean, just trying to be mean and tough, and it's kind of cool having, you know, somebody like that to make everybody smile and laugh when it's like such a serious sport. So I kind of enjoyed it, and Chael's the man, and he's good at what he does, and you know, I definitely had a great time at the press conference for sure.
You know, earlier you were talking about you know try not to think about the big stage and everything like that so much. How do you plan to keep your emotions in check when you walk out from behind that curtain and like you're walking in Madison Square Garden and people are everywhere? It's the biggest show Bellator's ever put on. How do you feel about that? Like, how do you feel about your nerves? Do you think you'll be able to keep those in line?
Yeah, you know, I think so. I guess you never know until you're in that exact situation.
Sure.
But, you know, I went to New York, and me and Chandler went out to Madison Square Garden. We faced off and squared off in there, and I walked in there and just looked around and was trying to visualize that, you know, hit pack in the cage in there. And, man, it's going to be pretty unbelievable, that's for sure. But at the same time, you know, I visualize myself working out in the back. Brent, you ready? You're 5 minutes, you're up. And yeah. I visualize myself walking out of the cage. I visualize every thousand of people, the crowd booing, the crowd cheering. Like, I really don't care. But I visualize all that, you know, a thousand times. I'm walking in the cage and me fighting Chandler. And so I think that's one thing, just meditating and just thinking about it over and over, and putting myself there before I'm there, you know. So
sure.
It's a mental game. It's a mental game for sure.
And my last question for you, man, what's the first thing you do after you win the title? Where's the first place you take that belt back to?
Well, I'm definitely going to go and celebrate in Eugene, my hometown, for sure, you know. But after I win that belt, I'm probably going to go eat some ice cream or cookies or donuts or something and probably have a couple shots of some whiskey and hang out with my family, man. It's going to be a good night for sure.
Sweet, man. Listen, I want to thank you for taking some time to talk with me. I know you're super busy with the card and all the obligations you have and stuff, so I really appreciate that you took some time to talk with us today, man. Thanks for coming on the show. Hopefully we can talk to
you
again
closer
to the fight, man.
Awesome, man. Thank you for having me. I really appreciate it.
All right, man. Have a great night.
You too.
All right. That was Brent Primus, champion, soon to be, maybe. We'll see what happens. He's got a big fight on his hands, and looking forward to it. June 24th. It's going to be a big, big card. We'll be right back with Steve Cazzola. 1 minute.
It was a fight about who would make a statement. It was Steve Cazzola making the statement, starting with the left hook, and then look at this flurry of punches. Fast, accurate, powerful. Jake Roberts out in the first round.
What's going on, everybody? We're back. We have Steve Cazzola on the line, fresh off a 28-second destruction of Jake Roberts. What's going on, Steve? How you doing? Thanks for coming to the Fight House.
Hey, thanks for having me. I really appreciate you having me back on, and always a pleasure, you know that.
Yeah, man, that was a great fight. You had a huge performance. How do you feel about it? I guess there's no way to feel bad about that.
That was just an amazing moment, man. I mean, just being back in my hometown of Chicago, Illinois, and having so much family and fans in the crowd, and, you know, just getting in there, performing, you know, to the best of my ability. First round knockout, no injuries. That's just about a perfect day right there.
It doesn't get any – hey, the check doesn't come any easier than that in the fight game.
Exactly. hey, man, you get paid the same. You get paid the same no matter what time you're in there for. So I'm in, I'm out, I'm ready to go again. Dylan Danis, Madison Square Garden, let's go.
That's it. Yeah, well, we're going to get to that in a minute. But I know when we talked before the fight, the one thing you were saying was that you were really happy to be able to get back in there after a lot of time away from the cage and showcase your skills and showcase where you're from, and you were ready for a war with Jake Roberts. It didn't turn out to be that. Were you a little upset that you didn't get to showcase more of your abilities?
No, it just wasn't meant to happen, I only show as much as I need to in order to get the victory. So I think there's a lot more of me to be seen from my striking game. I've only shown, not even 50% of my striking game, and my whole wrestling and my whole jiu-jitsu game has never been seen yet. So I'm just going to keep those in my back pocket, make sure I'm still growing, still learning, and pursuing perfection.
Well, were you surprised when you caught him so early and things went that way? Like, what were you feeling? Because I know even when you hit him, seemed to be like a slight hesitation, then you jumped all over him. Were you surprised?
Yeah, I was surprised that he went down like as hard as he did off the check. Off the check left hook.
Yeah.
I thought that was just kind of put him off balance a little bit, as opposed to like, it really put him out there a little bit. Just I think the spot where I hit just having to turn off the light a little, for a little bit, and then I just was like, okay, he's hurt. Follow through. So went in for the kill like I always do, and I should have. I'm seeing my combinations. I need to stay tighter next time. He's definitely worth the body. Definitely could have had some room for creativity, but I knew I was growing fast and hard and accurate enough that I was getting through his shell and was going to eventually put him out, just a matter of time.
That was a barrage you unloaded with, man, to be completely honest. That was a ridiculous combination of punches.
I would have gone for 7 to 10 more punches easily.
I was sitting
hard ones.
I was sitting beside one of my buddies. We were watching the fights because I watch them more as a fan because I love the sport so much. But I looked right at my buddy. I said, man, did that not remind you of Chuck and Tito when Chuck just unloaded against them on the fence? It just had that feel to it, man. It was a deadly combination. Go ahead.
It's what I'm trying to show, man. Like, I'm the second generation of this sport, Dan Henderson was the first generation of Team Quest. I'm the second generation of Team Quest. He's retired now. I'm now that American guy who knocks people out. That's going to step in and, go right in his shoes, follow his footsteps right from the bat, So I'm here now. I'm the one who's going to be making the noise. So I want everyone to, be put on blast, So I know I'm here.
One of the things that we talked about before the fight was your preparation. Like, talk a little bit about that, man, because it was crazy when you were talking about just how disciplined you are, and you said that was going to make the difference. You said that just my mental, physical, all that preparation is going to make the difference in this fight, and did it ever.
Yeah, I believe when you put in 100% of yourself into something, you put yourself in 100% the best position for for yourself to succeed. So I have to make sure that I cover as much gaps as I can, make sure I'm learning as much as I can, adapting as much as I can, and growing myself, not just physically, but mentally, spiritually. I need to make sure that the people around me, my championship environment, is 100% on point. And that's why I'm focusing all the time. I don't have time for, BS on any angle of anything. I have a wife and I have a son that are number one and number one, and then I got fighting I got to worry about and providing for them. So I'm not here to mess around, party, take shortcuts. No, I'm here to put in the work. And I've shown that I put in the work, whether I'm extremely active or whether I'm taking years off between fights for whatever adversity I'm going through at the time. I'm always improving, always getting better, staying disciplined. My weight is always perfect and it's always on point. I've never missed weight. I've never been healthy. I'm getting more healthy every time I step on the scale. It shows that it doesn't affect my power. I woke up at 158.5 pounds. Morning of weigh-ins, did a 20-minute bath with that, just a 20-minute bath. No Albaline, no Epsom salt, no nothing. Cut that weight easily, stepped on, and was eating full meals, three, four full meals a day. This is the type of preparation I'm doing. Like, that's the level I'm at, and if you're not there, good luck trying to beat me.
That's one of the things that I thought was one of the things you said to me, and it stuck with me from the interview, was that you said some people make weight and some people cut weight. And you said these guys aren't making weight, they're cutting weight.
Exactly.
And that stuck with me because I was like, that's such a good way to put it, is that some guys just are like yourself, are just super disciplined. And you said that you'll be stepping in there way stronger because you're just doing this everything the right way. And you were dead on, man.
Absolutely. I mean, I wanted to really show that separation from good versus great. You know, that's what I talked about, good versus great. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm not just a meathead. You know, I went to college. I got a degree in kinesiology. I've been studying the human body from a performance aspect, you know, pretty much since I was 17 years old, and I'm 27 now. That's 10 years of consistent research, and I've always been, you know, my number one experiment tool is myself and my own body and my own mind. So I've been growing this for 10 years, and now it's just been, you know, now it's just gotten on the platform that everybody's noticing, like, oh, shit, you know, he's got it together on all fronts. So that's why I said it's going to take a big man, you know, a special man to beat me, but I'm willing to step up against anyone who's willing to try.
You know, speaking of which, you've been heavy on Dylan Danis.
Absolutely.
And when we spoke, you had said to me, you were like, that's like, you know, I want to put that guy in check. I will knock him out. What is it about him that's got you? No, I don't want to say upset. I don't think you don't seem too emotional about it. You just seem more like, yeah, I'm going to put this guy in check. Like, what is your reasoning for kind of targeting him the way you have?
It's his lack of authenticity and staying true to his true self as a martial artist. He's a Marcelo Garcia black belt, a high level jiu-jitsu practitioner. You know, he was not acting the way he's been acting lately. He's completely copied Conor McGregor. You're not going to get far in life being a good copycat. Like, be you, be who Dylan Danis originally is and build off of that. Build the martial arts, build the jiu-jitsu. You know, look at Lovato. Rafael Lovato, look at how he's built himself. He's a hard worker, amazing jiu-jitsu practitioner, doing both MMA and jiu-jitsu because he puts in the work. You know, you don't see him trying to be all flashy and crazy and anything like that. So he's trying to come out like he makes all this money. Dude, if you have this money, Conor gave it to you for coaching. Congrats, you got hooked up with the right person at the right time. That's awesome. But if it comes easy, it's going to go just as easy. So he's going to come up against a, you know, second-generation authentic fighter who he cannot take down and will not be able to handle his hands. That's me. So if he can make 155 or even 162, you know, he has to fight me. I'm going to be the one he fights. I'm going to put him unconscious, bottom line. But if he can't make it down to that weight, if he's going to have to stay at 170, because he is a big guy, I don't think he can really even make the weight. He's going to do a 70. Then eventually he's going to run into my teammate Fernando Gonzalez, and he will destroy him as well. You know, and I think if you're going to pay him all this money and he's going to talk all this shit, he needs to step up and fight a real fighter right off the get-go. He's got multiple titles in jiu-jitsu. You know, he's all about, like, oh, I train with Conor McGregor, he's the best in the world. All right, then what's the problem, man? If Conor can fight Floyd Mayweather in a boxing match, then Dylan Danis should be able to fight me in an MMA match.
Fair enough.
Bottom line.
He's made some pretty huge statements. I don't know even how true they are. Some of them seem a little bit outrageous to me, but I don't know, right? Obviously, I'm not in the know. But what do you think about him saying, like, he's the highest paid fighter in Bellator and that 180 will flop without him on the card?
I think that's just him talking shit and trying to say Conor shit, to be honest. Like, dude, no, you're not. There's no way you're the highest paid guy. You don't have the name. You don't have the name or the credentials, dude. You know, I'm sure he's getting paid more than the first guy walking in on their, you know, first fight for sure. He's making more than average, but dude, you're not the highest paid guy. You know, those champions are making more for sure. You know, they're not like that. So he's just talking shit to get himself, in the spotlight. Good for him. You know, now it's got my attention and I'm going to come after him with everything I got.
Do you think he takes that fight with you at 180? Even because you said you were willing to meet him at a catch weight as well. What's the highest weight you're willing to go?
Anything that's not going to step on my boy Fernando's toes. Fernando's 170. If he wants to play, you know, 162 is fair. I think 162 is fair. I'll give you that. All right. Otherwise, you're going to go to 70. Then my boy Fernando will take care of it. He's a freaking beast. You know, he's a vet. He takes all the hard fights. You know, he's someone who's completely overlooked in that welterweight division. He's an animal, and he's only going to get better. Trust me. Him and I are going to be a freaking duo to be messed with, not to be messed with in Bellator. I'll tell you that.
You know, I feel like because of your time away, like I know it was like contract issues and stuff that you were dealing with between Bellator, World Series of Fighting, and just that whole time period. Do you think that people are just unaware of like how skilled you actually are? Like, I mean, you ran through Jake Roberts, a tough dude. He's 7-1, and you ran through him in 28 seconds. Like, do you think there's a lot of people that are really sleeping on you?
I think some people don't know how good I really am yet, and that's fine. You know, because, again, I've only had the show so much. Right. You know, wait till you put me up against these guys where I'm going to display my, you know, my full force, basically, show all my weapons and how effectively I am at putting them together. You know, I trust my team. I trust my coaches. I trust my mind. I trust my preparation. And I trust in my ability to come into the fight 100% on all levels and get it done and get it finished. again, I don't go in there saying first, second, third round. I don't go saying knockout submission. I do have, you know, little guesses in my head or ideas of how I can see it ending, but I am open to any and every way there is to finish that fight. That's my time slot. That's my octagon. I control the destiny. I control what goes on, and I go in there and handle business, whether it's in 30 seconds or 15 minutes.
You know, you've also called to be on the London card as well. I've seen some posts on social media about getting on the London card. Would you want to go on the London card if 180? Well, would you be able to do London and 180? Like, what's kind of more important to you guys? Seeing you kind of call for both.
It'd be one or the other,
yeah,
to be honest.
Yeah, absolutely.
Unless that's another 30-second or less than a minute bout, then I'll, you know, do both or whatever. I honestly think that's unrealistic.
Mm-hmm.
If 179 is full, like they say, then fine, 179 is full. Then give me Danis at 180. He says he's, you know, that card was soft. That card's going to do great with or without. No one cares about him. Everyone just wants to see him get his ass whipped now, right? So let's go. Like, I'm the only fight you got to make yourself relevant on that card. Anyone else besides me you fight, it's nothing. It does nothing for you at all. So he needs to step up and fight me, or he can step up and fight Fernando. We'll both be ready for New York, London, you know, tomorrow. We'll be ready to fight that guy whenever.
How would you feel about fighting him? Like, how good would it feel for you to fight him in New York in front of his home people, and be able to do some damage there?
It'd be awesome. Hey, I was just a hometown guy. Yep. I had my opportunity. It was a great stage for me. I had a wonderful moment. I am giving him this opportunity to have that same stage that I was at. I'm coming in. I'll be the bad guy. Now, you have all the backing in the world from New York, I'm sure. But, you know, watch how I expose you right off the bat. Watch how I crack you with the jab, and immediately you know this is in the game. You know, and even if he somehow does get me to the ground, which I highly doubt, watch all the shots of elbows that are going to be flying your way and just cracking you. You know no one's hit you 100% in sparring. You know that no one's hit you 100%. I'm going to hit you 100%, and I'm going to hit you harder than you've ever been hit before in your life, and you're going to want out of there.
You know, here's the thing. Do you think Bellator would even allow him to take that fight with you? Because, like, if I assess it honestly, he hasn't had a single mixed martial arts fight. So if I look at it honestly, I say, he's a huge investment for them. This is probably not the best fight for them to give him, to welcome him to MMA. Do you feel like they would in no way would even give him that fight?
Their initial reaction would be like, no, Dance has this name. We should build him. We should give him a chance. He's 0-0, yada, yada, yada. But think deeper. Go deeper than Danis, because they know that his time of being, you know, any type of money they're going to get from him, it's only going to be very short-lived, because everyone's going to start calling out for me if he keeps avoiding me. They're going to start calling out for real fighters, and he's going to keep on trying. He's going to be dodging them like the plague. All right?
Right.
They need to give him someone, you know, give him someone legit right off the bat and build that guy's name off of him, who's an authentic fighter who does this shit for his living. You know, this is his world, and see how far he can take you in the long run. Play the long game. All right?
Right.
So I would say double down. Give me this fight right now. Double down on me and watch, you know, watch how I can carry Bellator to the top, or, you know, be a part of that team that helps carry him to be like a serious contender, you know, with the UFC and any other promotion out there.
That's what
they should do.
Have you talked to anyone from Bellator? Have you pitched that idea to anyone from Bellator? Because it sounds about right to me.
My manager knows, and you know, I think the more media I do and the more I announce it to them, I think they're starting to think about it themselves. Like, he might have a point here. Let's see, you know. But I have received zero response from Danis. I received zero response from McGregor. I told McGregor to tell his boy he needs to step up, because I believe Conor's telling him, hey, dude, he just called you out. Those are fighting words. You need to call him out and fight him. That's how I think Conor would handle it. Who's ever called, you know, I don't think Conor's ever dodged anyone, so why is his star pupil, his coach, his boy, his, you know, right-hand man, I don't know what the hell he is, but why is he not doing this? Why is he not stepping up? He just got challenged.
What was it like for you to stand in the ring and be able to tell him all this, like, essentially to his face? He was only about, what, 30 feet away from you at the time?
I just felt like I was the voice of everyone else behind me who's, you know, who's not looking for, you know, these playboys to get all this, you know, notoriety for all of a sudden choosing to become a playboy, like faking it. Like, really, dude? Like, this is not who you are. You know, we can smell us from a mile away, you know? And I got the platform to pretty much tell the world what everyone was thinking, which is, dude, you're fake right now. You're copying Conor. Stop, dude. Just be you. That's, you know, get people behind you in that sense, you know? But I guess, you know, it pays quick to be the bad guy. But when you don't have the skills to back it up, then you're going to lose big.
Right. You know, how do you feel the fight goes with Dillon? If you end up, if he says to you, yeah, I'll take that fight at 180, how do you think that fight goes?
I finish him. I don't care whether it's in the first, second, or third round, whether it's by knockout or submission. I finish him.
You don't think he makes it out?
I'm sorry?
I said you don't think he makes it out of the fight. You think you're going to definitely finish him
100%? No, I will 100% finish him.
Okay.
100%.
You know,
I mean, no disrespect, I haven't been wrong yet.
That's,
all right?
That's also
you know,
true.
I come in there to throw hands, and I'm ready first round, I'm ready second round, and I'm ready third round. All right? If you don't believe me, give me someone who's willing to try.
You know, that's my next question was, if not Dillon Danis, who you're a very smart guy, and you obviously plot things out, and you have a plan. So who, if not Dillon Danis, who's another guy on the radar that's going to get you in the direction you're looking to go?
You know, Adam Piccolotti. He's 9-0. I'm 8-0. He's a black belt in jiu-jitsu. I'm sure everyone's waiting to see me go against the black belt now and see how I can hang. You know, he's a good size for the weight, you know, and I'm, you know, showing my stuff about how I can easily make weight. They're California guys. He's NorCal. I'm SoCal. Let's go. You know, I respect his skills. I respect, you know, everything he's done. I think he's an authentic guy. I would not take him lightly, but I know I will finish him as well.
Nice. Well, how do you see that fight going? Do you think it's a knockout? How do you see yourself finishing him?
I see myself finishing. I don't care whether it's in the first, second, or third round, whether it's by knockout or submission. Fair I will
enough.
Win.
Awesome.
Keep myself open to every single possibility. Again, after I assess it and it's in ink, I will have my own little prediction that I share with my one buddy.
Fair
and
enough.
We've been wrong. Or we haven't been wrong yet. So, you know, otherwise, I always keep myself open for any type of finish that could happen.
How long do you think it is before you end up with a title shot? What's your time frame?
What
are you
giving
yourself?
I don't.
It's not about
a
title.
I really don't. I would like to get my 3-fight out of the way, and then we'll renegotiate, and then that'll be a good title spot. I think being 11-0 and all finishes would be me in good title contention, either number one contender or title fight, right there, and we'll renegotiate for what my family deserves.
What do you think about the title fight that's about to go down at 180? What do you think about Chandler versus Primus?
You know, I haven't really looked into it too much, man. I don't really know too much about Primus, to be honest. You know, I'm a family man. When I get the chance to watch fights, I do. But otherwise, I'm spending time with my beautiful wife and my amazing son and, you know, just being a part of their lives and enjoying everything. So I don't get to watch every single fight that I would like or anything like that. But I have to do my research. But honestly, I see Chandler. I don't see guys less experienced, than Chandler beat him. I think Chandler's a very smart fighter. He's an authentic guy. He uses his wrestling with his striking really well. He can knock you out and as well be a dangerous top position type of guy as well. He's got a heavy base, got a good wrestler mentality. So I see it being a difficult task for anyone in the division to dethrone Chandler. It can be done. It will be done. But I don't think Primus is the guy to do it.
All right. Well, listen, man, I want to thank you for coming on the show. You're a very accessible guy, and I really thank you for that. And I hope you get that fight with Dillon Danis, man. I would love to see it go down at 180. I think it would be a great fight for the card. I look forward to it.
I appreciate it, brother. Thank you for having me on. It's always great talking to you, man. Love our conversations. God bless.
All right. Thanks, man. God bless you, too. Take care, bud.
Yeah. Bye-bye.
Bye. Well, that was Steve Cazzola, and he's got a lot of opinions about Mr. Dillon Danis. We'll see what Bellator does. We'll see if they end up facing off at 180. And it's definitely a fight I'm interested to see go down. And we'll be back with Dom Pilarte from LFA. Give us a couple.
Judge 2 scores the bout 29-28, Pilarte. And Judge 3 scores the bout 29-28 for your winner by split decision, Domingo Golden Boy Pilarte.
All right, we're back, and we got Dom Pilarte from LFA on the line. Hey, Dom, how you doing? Well, thanks for coming on to the show, man.
Yeah, thank you guys for having me, man. Doing really good, well, just resting up after the fight. How you guys doing?
We're doing good, man. We're doing good. Just getting the show on, man. First thing to say is how do you feel after the fight? What do you think of the fight? How did you feel about it?
It was a good fight, I knew I was fighting a tough guy, man, Adrian. He surprised me, with how quick he was, and how prepared he was to avoid my left hand. and my left kicks, you know, he was his defense was on point, you know. But I feel good, you know. I watched the fight, you know, probably about 10 times now, broke it down. And, I mean, you know, from looking at the stats and counting everything, I mean, you know, I won all three rounds, you know, easily. And, you know, it was I felt it shouldn't have been a split, but, you know, it happened.
Well, why do you feel it was a split? Like, what do you think kind of moved them in that direction? Was there, in your breakdown, did you see anything that you're like, okay, maybe this was what they were looking at? Or
yeah, well, like, you know, I think, man, I don't want to, you know, I think a lot of it was the hype around him. Not to say that it was, you know, not undeserved hype, because, you know, I mean, he's a really good fighter. But I think maybe, you know, his fans were a lot louder than mine. You know, I know I had a lot of people there, but they weren't screaming as loud. And I don't know, you know, I think they, you know, he's younger, he's a good prospect, and I think they were just behind him a little bit more, you know. And they, you know, I mean, I just felt kind of like the commentators too, man, were more on his side. And I didn't really get any credit for the shots that I landed. You know, I mean, I broke the fight down, and I mean, total strikes thrown, you know, for me was like almost 70, about 66, probably about 40 of those landed. You know, total strikes for him, man, and I counted them, you know, it was 36. You know, and I made him miss a lot. You know, he had maybe four or five good punches, you know, throughout the whole fight. I mean, I scored 9 takedowns, you know, 2 in the first, 4 in the second, and 3 in the third. And, you know, he had 0 takedowns the whole fight. You know, I threw about 25 kicks. He threw 9. You know, I think it was just, too, the third round, man. I, you know, he hit a good switch on me. The last takedown, one of the last takedowns I hit, he hit a good switch, and I pulled my hamstring. So as soon as we got back up and he backed me up against the cage, that's why I was a sitting duck, you know. It wasn't so much that I was tired or hurt. I pulled my hamstring, man, and as soon as I stood up, you know, I didn't have my left leg underneath me, and I kind of had to post up against the fence those last 30 seconds and just bob and weave on the fence. But, you know, I ended up finishing with another takedown, you know. But, I mean, like I said, I broke the fight down, man, and he won about, I'd say, maybe, you know, 2 minutes of the third round. The other three I won, and then I clearly won the first two, you know. So you know, it happens, you know.
It's interesting that you say that comes out now about your hamstring, because when I was watching the fight, actually, I had given him the third round based on that, because I thought he hurt you. I was like, you know what, he was putting it on him. Like, he looked, you appeared to be like you were, I don't want to say rock, because you didn't look like you were on wobbly legs or anything, but you, like you said, you were backed up against the fence, you're kind of fighting off the fence, right? So that kind of makes a lot of sense, because it appeared like you were hurt. So maybe that's what the judges were seeing, or something to that effect, maybe.
Yeah, for sure. Because, man, like I said, it was one of the last takedowns, the second to last takedown I hit, actually, up against the fence, and he dove over for a switch and pulled it. And when he dove over for that switch, it happened so fast, I had to kind of post my left leg and stretch it out to stop, you know, to stop from getting rolled. And as I did that, it just popped. I heard it pop. I felt it pop. And then that's when I rolled up off against the cage and kind of took side. And then I couldn't even hold side control. And he recovered guard right away and got up. Because, man, my leg was, you know, in a lot of pain. And you can see, if you watch the fight, as soon as we stand up, you'll see my left leg buckle. It did buckle, and I remember it because I felt it. Yeah. My hamstring was, you know, pretty bruised after that. But that's exactly why I stood up against the fence. I mean, I was fine. He might have landed maybe 1 or 2 decent shots, but I blocked both of the head kicks, and I was completely fine, man. You know, I mean, I don't have anything. You know, if somebody hurts me in a fight, I'll say, yeah, man, he got me with a good shot, you know. But he didn't, you know. He hit me, but it didn't hurt me. And it was all hamstring, man. You know, I pulled it pretty bad. I had a deep bruise on it after the fight, and it bothered me. I was really happy that it happened the last 30 seconds of the fight, because if it would have been earlier, you know, I would have been in some trouble, man, because I really didn't have use of my left leg after that.
You know, you also, in our conversation before you coming on the show here, brief conversation, you said that you also hurt your hand and your foot. How's everything healing up, and what happened there? Was it just from throwing kicks? From, you know, how'd that happen?
Yeah, so my left foot, I think I hurt it in the first round.
Okay.
It was one of the, you know, he did a good job, man, of blocking my high kicks. You know, I was hammering him out there. One of them caught his elbow. And then I think what made it even worse was the second round. I think it was the second round when he hit me with a leg kick at the opening bell, and I returned it with an inside kick. And I think that inside kick, I hit him pretty hard, but I think it brushed off his knee. And then from then on, man, my foot was in a lot of pain, and I really couldn't, I really couldn't put a lot of pressure on it. So when I did have him down on the ground, I really couldn't pass. I remember I was trying to pass a lot, And my foot just hurt so bad. I was like, geez, you know, it's like there's no way I'm going to be able to pass it. I mean, I couldn't even put any weight on it, which was part of the reason why, man, when I did get a takedown, I really couldn't do much, you know, and that happened early. And my right hand, it was fine throughout the whole fight. It was, I think it was three or four. You have to really pay attention to see these punches, man. You know, they were kind of fast. I hit him with three or four good check right hooks in the third round, and one of them hit the top of his head, man, and it messed my hand up pretty bad. And my foot's healing good. The hamstring's healing good. My right hand, though, my index finger, it's that knuckle, it's pretty messed up. So I'm going to see my sports doctor tomorrow, actually, and he's going to take a look at everything for me. But it's, you know, it's healing, but it's a slow process, you know. Definitely sure. More of my offense that damaged myself, you know.
How soon do you think you'll be back training, and like, when do you think you'll be ready to get back into the cage?
But I was already, you know, chomping at the bit to get back in the gym. You know, I want to get back in there. I was happy that my fight went three rounds because I got a lot of experience. You know, I finished a lot of my fights pretty quick, and I wanted to get some more ring time, you know, to see, you know, hey, how did my weight cut affect me? How did the rehydration go? Did what I do for cardio, was it good enough? And I mean, you know, I was happy to get the experience and to see, hey, you know what, I rehydrated properly, this worked, I didn't get tired here. But hopefully I'll be back in the gym. I already started doing a light stuff, but maybe I think within another week or two, and then I'm going to try to shoot for maybe, what are we in, April, mid-April, so like May, June, July. I'm going to try to shoot for July, you know, to be back in there.
Is there a name on your tongue, man? Anybody you'd like to get in there with? They're going to move you. Anybody you'd like to get in there with and move you in the direction you want to go? Is there a name on your tongue?
Yeah, you know, I was supposed to fight Cody Williams back in when was it? It was February, actually, in Louisiana, and that fight fell through. And then I was supposed to fight him again here in Houston, you know. And then that one fell through, and I ended up fighting Chris Spann. But you know, he's one of the guys I would, you know, like to get in there. He's got a great name, you know. He's got a lot of fight fans. He's exciting. I respect him as a fighter. He's, you know, he's a great fighter. He's got a lot of experience. He's another guy, you know, that I would feel would be a step up for me, and it'd be a good challenge, you know. Other than him, you know, there's a few other guys that we're thinking about, you know, seeing what you know, what's available and see how it goes.
How far do you think you are away from like a potential title shot?
Well, I don't know. You know, that's a good question. You know, I mean, you finish every fight like I used to. You know, I think I had six finishes out of the seven wins, including my amateur fight. You know, and I go to a decision, you know, once or twice, and you know, fans are like, "Oh man, you know, he's boring." You know, you can't finish every fight, man. You can't go in there and just knock everybody out in the first round, the first, you know, minute. It's just not going to happen. You're going to fight guys that are tough, that are good, you know. But based on this last performance, I think, you know, the promotion would have wanted to see a finish. So they might make me have another fight or so before they offer me something like that. But, you know, I'm looking to get into the UFC, man, you know, if not later this year, you know, for sure at the end of this year, you know, and I'd be open to, you know, doing an Ultimate Fighter as well next time they have my weight class, you know. So I'm just, you know, going to take it slow and train and just, you know, kind of see what happens.
Have you had any contact with the UFC? Have you reached out to them? Have you spoke with anybody? And, like, what's the response been like, if you have?
Well, I have a good, you know, relationship with Mick Maynard. And, you know, he's one of the matchmakers now. I used to actually train with him at 4 Ounce because he trains at one of the gyms I train at.
Okay.
And, you know, I've fought for him for a few years. There was a fight that they needed a replacement. I think it was back in January, I think, and I had messaged Mick about it, and he was open to the idea. You know, he went on ahead and talked to Sean Shelby about it, and, you know, he told me, you know, hey, sit tight, let's see what we can do. And turns out the guy that was going to fight actually ended up pulling off of the card completely, and he chose to fight at another time, so that fight was completely scrapped. But, you know, having that, you know, communication with Mick Maynard, it's there, you know. He's open to the idea, you know, to helping me get on a show, and I know some guys out at Elevation, you know, that would help me. I think it's a matter of just, you know, the right opportunity, you know. Mm-hmm. Whenever somebody in my weight class gets hurt and they need a replacement, you know, I'll be ready. I'll shoot a text to Mick and say, hey, Mick, man, put me in. Let's do this. And I know he'll push for me. You know, he knows I'm an exciting fighter. I've finished nearly all my fights, and you know, he knows I, you know, I have the skill level to be there. So I think it's just a matter of time, you know.
You know, I talked to you before the fight with Adrian Yanez, and one of the things you said to me was that you were really looking to use your reach much better because of the, you know, it was something you were working on since the Machado fight, and you didn't use your tools properly in that fight. Do you feel like you used the reach the way you wanted to against Yanez?
For sure. See, that's something that I think I did really well. I did watch the third round, and I saw I did back up a little bit more. But if you know, you watch it, I'm clearly not running. You know, mm-hmm. Running is when you turn your back completely. And I don't know, you guys have seen that in a lot of MMA fights where the guy just turns his back and kind of runs. I was circling to my left, and the fact that Adrian wasn't able to cut off the ring, that's not really my fault. That's not my problem. You know, if he would have cut the ring off, that wouldn't have happened. But I was able to, you know, use footwork, and I did use my reach. You know, like I said, I made him miss a lot, you know. I should I have done more? Yes, I agree with that. I should have countered more with as much as I made him miss. I should have countered more. I wish I could have been more active on the ground. Like I said, I was fighting through some, you know, injuries that happened in the first round. You know, I fought through it. But he's a great fighter. You know, that's one thing that a lot of people don't seem to miss, you know, how good he really was. You know, he was 6-0 as an amateur with about, I think, like 5 knockouts, and he's 5-1, you know. So he had an overall record of 11-1. You know, this kid is really, really good. And he's, you know, he's lit up a lot of guys that he's fought. And for me to go in there and completely neutralize his offense where he couldn't reach me and couldn't really land anything clean, I mean, you know, I didn't get any praise for that, you know, using my shoulder rolling, evading. You know, I mean, like I said, they were expecting me to go out there the way I did with Machado.
Yeah.
And if I would have done that, I would have just given him so much more of a better chance to win the fight when, you know, all I had to do was use my kicks and jabs, hooks, and just stay away. And, you know, that's what I did. And he couldn't really reach me the whole fight. And then when he got too aggressive, I just put him on his back.
Was there anything about his skills that surprised you, or anything the other way that you thought he would be better at, or that would be more of a challenge for you that wasn't really a problem?
Yeah, I thought he would have, I guess my, you know, when I look back at the fight, there was a lot of things that I did, and they're very subtle. So like I said, you have to kind of really pay attention. I did, one thing that Dwayne Ludwig teaches a lot at his school is pump fakes. And you'll see when I, you know, when I back away or I, you know, do the boxer's walk, you know, I'm kind of just dancing. I'll pump fake them. You know, I pump faked them a lot. And just by doing a pump fake, it disrupts, you know, your whole offense. If you were going to throw a combination, if you were going to throw a jab or whatever you were about to throw, when I pump fake and you react to that pump fake, it throws everything off. I pump faked them, I don't know, at least, you know, a good 5 or 6 times. Then, like I said, you have to really kind of pay attention to see what I did. And then I'd shoot for a takedown. You know, some people were saying, oh, you know, my shots were kind of blind and I wasn't setting them up. That, you know, that's not true. If they would have been paying attention and really watched me, they would have really seen how I was setting up my shots. Just because I set them up really subtle doesn't mean I wasn't setting them up, you know?
When you were in the cage, and you heard and you knew it was a split decision, were you surprised in the ring when it was, or worried at all when you found out, like, okay, this is going to be a split decision? And you're waiting for the last card?
Yeah, you know, I was surprised that it was a split, but when they said split, I mean, there was I was worried when I fought Joel Scott and they said split because I was like, whoa, wait a second. I clearly took all 3 rounds. But with Adrian, I was kind of worried when they said split, but then I was like, there's no way they can give him the fight, you know. I mean, it looked, you know, it was one of those things, you know, when you're watching a fight live and you're looking through the cage, it's kind of hard to see how everything goes down versus getting the bird's eye view when you watch it on TV, you know.
Sure.
So when I watched it, you know, I was surprised it was a split, but, you know, I just, there's no way. I mean, in all fairness, let's say, you know, even though, like I said, the third round I got 3 takedowns and he got none. He landed about 22 shots, or he threw about 22, but I think, I don't know, he probably landed like maybe 10 of those. And I threw about 17 punches, I counted, and I probably landed like maybe 10 of those as well. You know, I mean, with 3 takedowns to none in the last round, I mean, I don't really see how you could give him that one. The aggression, yeah, but whenever, like I said, the bird's eye view, when you watch him throw those flurries, I blocked him and rolled almost everything, you know. It's just perspective, you know, they said. But, you know, hey, if you give him that 3rd round, that's still 2-1, you know, which is how the other judges saw it, which is, I mean, that's fair, but there's no reason why that shouldn't have been a split. But, you know, like I said, it happened. You know, I wish, you know, Pat would have not been as biased as he sounded, you know, because when I landed kicks, like I landed a good head kick, you know, that he complained about an eye poke, and I didn't see that happen anywhere, and the ref stopped it. You know, I got hit with about, I think I counted almost 10 illegal elbows, and I got cut right in the back of the head. Like I had a cut right in, straight at the back of my head. I mean, the ref, you know, just didn't even really even say anything to him about those, you know, and I know he probably didn't do them on purpose, but still, you know, I didn't get any help from the ref. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you know, I was just had everything kind of going against me, but at the end of the day, I did what I had to do to win, you know, so I didn't think they were going to take it from me.
You said that you watched the fight nearly 10 times. You've counted every punch. Are you usually that meticulous about a fight, or was it just something about this fight, or do you do that with all your fights?
No, it's only the ones that were close. Like the ones that I finished, you know, which was almost all of them, I didn't really have to go back and see because a lot of them were short. But like the one with Joel Scott that went 3 rounds, the one with Machado that went 3 rounds, and this one, I watched those probably, you know, 100 times and counted everything. Even my fight with Machado, man, he's my friend, you know, but when I look back at that fight, man, I counted everything up. I outlanded him, like, I think it was 4 takedowns to 2, like 10 submission attempts to like 2, you know, and I outstruck him, you know. It was just the perspective in that fight. I did get a little tired, put my hands on my knees, which probably cost me the fight. But, you know, I do break them down, and I am pretty, you know, particular about counting everything and making sure, you know, and I did that for this one too, because, you know, as people were saying, oh, you know, Adrian got robbed. And I mean, it's just ridiculous. You know, the first round was clearly me. The second round, he had 2 punches. Literally, you can count them. No takedowns, no dominant positions, 2 punches and 3 kicks. And I think maybe I blocked like 2 of those kicks or all of those kicks, actually, except one leg kick landed. You know, I had 6 punches, 3 kicks, 4 takedowns, you know, an elbow, a knee in that round. I mean, I was much more active. There's just really no way he won the fight when you add up. And I wish we would do, you know, CompuBox numbers like they do in boxing, you know, to add them up, you know.
Right. You know, is there anything that what do you want to improve on? Like, what did in all this that you watched that you broke everything down? Was there anything in your game that you were like, okay, I got to obviously do this a little bit better, or that I need to work on this or tighten this up? What was the things you took away from it?
Yeah, for sure. This one, like I said again, I was happy with my performance because I made him miss a lot, and I practically shut down his offense with, you know, using pump fakes, takedowns when he was too aggressive, you know, keeping away. You know, I used a lot of side kicks. He did do a really good job at getting away at a lot of those. That's something I want to work more on. You know, that was the most I've ever thrown in a fight, but I've been doing them for years now. I want to use those more, you know, use more front kicks, set my head kicks up better. My jab I got to use a lot in this fight. That's something that I want to use even more. I wish I would have jabbed him more, you know, looking back on it. And another thing I'm going to work a lot on is, you know, I come from more of a jiu-jitsu background than wrestling.
Okay.
So I want to kind of get more of, you know, more aggression on the ground. I'm used to holding position and, you know, passing instead of, you know, just trying to ground and pound a guy. You know, and another thing that Adrian did really well, man, was he put his feet on my hips, you know, which stopped a lot of my passing. You know, he was ready to just get up and push me off, which he did a few times. You know, so it's not as easy as it looks, you know, when you're watching from the outside. You know, I felt his feet on my hips, and I wasn't always able to pass. But just be more aggressive on bottom, that's one thing I want to do. And, you know, use my reach more. Basically what I did in the fight, but, you know, take it to the next level, get even better at it, and encounter more too, you know.
Right on. Listen, man, I want to really thank you for coming on and giving us some of your time here, man. It's always good to talk to you. It's always a good conversation. I hope to see you back in there sooner than later. And, yeah, man, thanks again.
Hey, thank you guys at the Fight House, man. You guys are awesome, and thank you for having me.
All right, awesome, man. Have a great night, eh? Be safe out there.
All right, you too.
All right, later, man. That was Don Pallarte. Great guy, great fighter. Great fight with Adrian Yanez. It's good to hear his breakdown on it. You know, some stuff you don't get to hear all the time, the inside stuff. We're going to be back with the last interview of the night, Steven Peterson. He's going to have a little bit of a response for the comments of Delani Perry. See you soon.
Steven LJ Peterson!
Right, welcome back to the Fight House. We're here with the last interview of the evening, last but not least. Steven Peterson from LFA. How you doing, Steve? Steven, how's everything going? Thanks for coming to the Fight House.
Going pretty great. I appreciate you having me on, man.
Absolutely, man. How's everything going? You're coming off, you know, it was a tough loss, your last one out with Higo. How's everything after that? How's your headspace? How's everything going?
My head's great. I mean, you know, obviously that's a setback. Yeah. I would have liked to get the victory, but, you know, it's just back to the drawing board, see my mistakes in the fight and, you know, on to just becoming a better fighter and a better athlete in general.
What's the one thing you took from the fight, the most important thing when you assessed your performance?
Really, reaction time, speed, need to work. I knew I needed to work on those things, but it was kind of, exposed in that fight. And, you know, there's always things to work on, but, that was his strong suit. And, you know, just really need to focus on hand speed, my defense and, you know, just creating more opportunities. I had a couple opportunities to finish the fight and, you know, the more the merrier. If I create a couple more, I could have got a finish. So, you know, just making more opportunities in the fight to find finishes.
True. You know, the one thing, so we brought you on the show today, is you've kind of hit on the radar for this, this 3-0 newcomer to LFA, Delonnie Perry. Have you heard anything about the fight, or did this all come out of the blue for you? Did they contact you from LFA or anything?
Yeah, I was contacted by Colin Cantrell after the big speech that Delonnie had, saying Legacy had nobody for him, UFC's mm-hmm. got nobody for him. So, yeah. You know, he's 3-0 and he's talking a big game. So I guess I figured we'd show him what we got for him. You know, I'm a former Legacy champ, so I'm about as good as they get. So that. He wanted the biggest fight he can get in Legacy, and now he's got it, and now he's got to back up his words.
Have you guys signed contracts? Like, is this a go? Is this set? Is this going to happen?
Oh, man, I'm waiting on the contract. that's why I haven't announced it, but I figured I'd throw the, you know, the hook out there and see if the fans bite, and the fans are all over it. So now it's on to negotiating, and I'm just waiting on a date, really. I can't wait to get in there and, you know, put him in his place.
What did you think about his performance at LFA 7? What was your thoughts on it? If you watched the fight, what did you think?
Yeah, just arrogant and very unimpressive. I mean, if you're going to act like that, you need to be finishing guys. You need to be making guys look bad. And it was just a sloppy fight, and there's really no place for the clowning. He didn't outclass the guy he fought by any means. He was a little bit better. But nothing impressed me. I see a lot of holes in his game that, you know, he's going to get exposed when we get to step in the cage together.
What do you think about him saying that, like, you know, that, like, him going to decisions is on purpose? He's doing it for the entertainment aspect of the fans, and that he's just clowning with everybody he's in there with and just toying with them and has no interest in finishing them. Do you think that's all, like, horse shit, or do you think there's any, like, truth to the fact that he's just trying to be an entertainer?
Yeah, that's a load of shit. He's just full of talk. I mean, he's out there saying he's never, you know, been punched in a fight. I mean, I watched him get punched in that fight. So it was a split decision win. He got taken down, put in side control. He ate a couple elbows in that fight. So you know, he's just got a big mouth, and I can't wait to shut him up and just expose his weaknesses, because you know, there's really no room for clowning unless you're just, you know, Anderson Silva really not getting hit and you're actually hurting your opponent. The idea is to win the fight and actually hurt your opponent, not run around and dance and try and not get hit, you know?
Now, obviously before you knew that you were going to be the guy, what were your thoughts when he was talking after the fight and you're watching this guy talking in the middle of the ring and he's saying some outrageous stuff? What were you thinking you knew you were the guy?
Yeah, I was shocked. I was shocked hearing you know, just the arrogance that he's speaking. It's my first reaction was I wish that he had more fights so I could fight him. And then my name gets brought in the mix, and then he goes you know, publicly bashing me. So he got the fight. I mean, he got what he wanted, and it's not going to be what he thought it was. It's not going to turn out the way he plans.
What do you think about some of the stuff this guy's saying about you? This guy, I mean, he's going pretty far. You know, he's saying basically like you've been knocked out. You've been like, you know, you're completely overrated. You should get a day job at Burger King. I'm reading like just he's the face of mixed martial arts. You know, he's going off pretty well on you. You know, and then even on our Instagram post actually announcing you on the show. I don't know if you read it, but he had a lot to say. I don't know. Like, what are your thoughts?
Yeah,
you see this guy
I don't
going
really
like
read
that?
Too much into that.
Yeah.
I don't really, you know, I don't go out looking for, you know, negative things people say about me. But now that you bring it to light, I mean, it's just there's no backing to his statements. I mean, I fought the best competition around possible since the beginning of my career. Of course, you're gonna have setbacks when you're trying to be the best. I've been ranked number one in the Southwest for the last 4 or 5 years. Won a pro championship, defended it 3 times. Won the Legacy World Championship, so I'm a high level full time mixed martial artist, and I just don't think he knows what he's saying. He doesn't understand the depth and the time on the mat that it actually takes to get good at this stuff, and he hasn't been in there with anybody near the caliber of me. So when he does, he'll get to taste those same defeats, and with his arrogance, I don't think he's going to bounce back like I did. I've gotten better from all my losses. Somebody like him, once he gets exposed, he's going to disappear. He's not going to be heard of again.
You know, when I was talking to him, one of the things that he said that I was like, wow, is he said to me, he says, first of all, he said that nobody in the bantamweight division in LFA, in Ultimate, in the UFC, nobody, they all suck. Everyone sucks, he said. And he said that when he trains with these guys in the UFC, he doesn't even wear a mouthpiece. You're a guy that circles the gyms. You've been in a lot of gyms, I'm sure. Is that a crazy thing for someone to say, like from a guy like in your perspective?
Yeah, he hasn't been training with a very high level of competition, if that's the case. I mean, what's he going to some garage gyms or something? I never heard of him before this past weekend before he fought for Legacy. So, you know, he hasn't been training with high level opponents or high level training partners. So, you know, if you're training with amateurs, sure, you can walk around without a mouthpiece, but it's just arrogant, and there's really not much else to say about it.
How do you see a fight with him playing out? When you look at his skill set and you assess it, how do you see you guys match up, and how do you see that playing out?
Well, I think it's funny he calls himself a BJJ practitioner, being only a purple belt, as he claims. I don't see any real competition background in the BJJ game, so and just the holes in his game, I think I'd have my way with him and be able to finish him at will. I feel like the submissions will be there early in the first, and but that's not really the way I want to go about it. I want to break him. I want to take him down, demoralize him, you know, grind him out and pound him out late in the first round. I want to make him pay for his statements, and I just want to humiliate him in the cage.
Do you want to try to drag it out as long as you can? Kind of what he's saying he wants to do with you. It's kind of exactly what he said in those posts on social media
stuff. Well, don't get me wrong. This will not go past the second round. I'm going to break him, and then I'm going to put him away like he deserves. I'm not going to take it to a decision. I'm not going to clown around. I'm going to go in there, and I'm going to hurt him. And I'm gonna break his will and make him never want to step in the cage with another fighter like me again.
Is there anything in his skill set that you look at and you're like, wow, okay, you know, he does have some skills, or his striking's on point, or anything? Like, is there anything that you see in his skills that you're like, oh yeah, it could be something to worry about?
No, I mean, he's long, he's athletic, so with that length, he's able to, you know, keep his head out of range of a lot of the strikes, but my striking is a lot better than basic. I'm gonna find my strikes, and you know, he's gonna eat a lot of body shots. He's gonna eat the kicks. He's gonna eat it all. I mean, I'll break him down systematically, and you know, it'll be very entertaining to watch, especially if he tries to pull that clown shit on me. I wish he would try to clown me. I'll put him to sleep.
Do you think that arrogance is going to be his biggest downfall when he gets in there with you?
Yes, that's you know, if he would have kept his mouth shut, then he could have kept building his career up. You know, fight another 1-0 or, you know, 2-2 type guy and keep building his career up and stay undefeated. But he's going to fight somebody like me, and he's just going to get absolutely embarrassed. And with all the talking that's been going on, I think he'll just, you know, go under the radar after that and won't be heard from again.
Now, here's the thing. When I look at this fight, you know, obviously his trash talk is what got him the fight. He got in, he talked a bunch of smack, and it's landed him a fight. But this seems like a step backwards for you. You know what I'm saying? Like,
oh, definitely. I mean, it's definitely a step down in competition. But at this point, I fought Leandro Higo, which is, he's the champ. He just went to Bellator. He's fighting for the Bellator world title now. So he's out of the picture. Anybody I fight would be a step back in competition. So, so somebody like this that calls me out, I look at it as a win, a good way to, you know, give the fans something to enjoy, and more importantly, just get back on the right track and towards the UFC. And I need one, maybe two more impressive victories, and you know, this one looks to be a great matchup for me, and you know, pretty solid win, and then move on, and you know, hopefully fight another contender at that point and move up to the UFC.
Do you think that this a win over him will carry weight though? You know what I mean? Like if you're looking for a few wins to get to the UFC, he's 3-0. He hasn't, at to this point, he hasn't really beat a name, really.
No, I mean he's definitely not a name. But there's not many more names for me to fight.
I understand that, yeah.
I fought the best I can fight my whole career up until this point. So at this point, I just need to get a win or two and get in the UFC so I can start making some money. I've always been going after the titles, trying to be a champion my whole career, and I've done that over and over again. At this point, I want to get to the UFC and fight the high-level guys, take those tough fights in the UFC so I can actually get paid for them. As far as carrying any weight, I mean, it's a win on my record. So I see guys that go 8-0, and everybody on their record has losing records. Nobody on my record has a losing record. I've always fought winners, and this guy's undefeated. So beating it's 3-0, it doesn't matter. It's a win against an opponent with a pretty good record. I mean, undefeated. So he's not 0-3. So it carries some weight there.
Okay.
Fans want to see it, and that's what matters. Putting fans in the seats is what matters. We're here, number one, to fight, number two, to entertain. If we weren't entertaining people, then you know, we wouldn't be making any money. So I think this would be a very entertaining fight for the fans, and you know, it'll be something that they really look forward to seeing, rather than such a competitive fight. This guy thinks he's going to clown me. I'm going to go destroy him, and it'll be great to watch.
You know, it definitely has gathered a ton of hype. Like, I was looking online today. I was following it when you had put up a post yourself saying, like, you're going to humble him, and you had, you know what you said, you had your own post, right? And then it was like 120 responses to it. Like, there's clearly a buzz for this fight. So, yeah, I have to agree with you, man. It's definitely going to throw some butts and some seats.
A lot of people are looking forward to seeing it. I think a lot of
people want to see you humble him. I'll be honest, a lot of it. But it's definitely gathered some steam, I'd have to agree. And it's good to know that it's actually – so it is 100% going to happen. This fight is a done deal. It's just now a matter of negotiating and coming up with a date. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, as long as he signs the contract and shows up. I mean, I've had guys run their mouth and then never show up fight night. So as long as he shows up, it'll happen. And, you know, it's up to the fans to you know, keep him into it and, you know, hold him to his word, make him back up his big mouth.
You know, you were a legacy champion. How important is it you get the LFA belt, or is it just like that's kind of like a, you know, not of most importance? More important is to get these few wins and get to the UFC, or would you like to grab that LFA title on that route?
Right, yeah, it would definitely be very nice.
Mm-hmm.
it's just got to make sense. I mean, I think another win should put me right back in contention for the title. But if I get offered a fight with the UFC, that's much more important.
Sure.
I feel like I've already, you know, been a world champion. So that would be, you know, reaccomplishing a goal that I've already accomplished. I'm trying to go on to bigger and better things. If it means capturing the legacy belt again, or the LFA belt at this point, then great. And then hopefully I would get picked up right after that. But that's not really a priority for me at this point. The priority is to get into the big show and you know, start making some money in the sport.
Are you open to, like, maybe Bellator, or is it are you dead set on the UFC? Because Bellator is starting to look like they're making a real move. I'm not going to say they're on par with the UFC, because I don't think that's an accurate statement. But they are definitely making a move. If you look at their signings, they're starting to do pay-per-views. Their cards are getting a lot deeper. Would you be open to going somewhere like Bellator?
Yeah, if I saw a contract and the money was right, definitely. But I'm definitely I'm looking forward to being the best in the world. I want to be at the top, and right now that's the UFC.
True.
And a win in the UFC, or even a loss with the type of fights that I put on, is $50,000. You know, right now I'm getting fight of the nights almost every time I fight, and right now it's a pat on the back. UFC, that's a big check. So, you know, I'm looking at my future, and I want to have something to fall back on when I'm done fighting. Mm-hmm. Can only do this for, you know, maybe 10 more years, so I really want to, you know, make a run at the top of the division, and that's in the UFC.
When you look at the UFC's bantamweight division, is there anyone that you'd like to step in there more than any, like, somebody else? You know, is there one guy that, or two guys that you'd really like to step in there?
I want to fight the top three: T.J. Dillashaw, Cody Garbrandt, and Dominic Cruz. Those are, you know, some of my favorite fighters to watch, and you know, I study them all the time. I feel like I could hang in there with them. I feel like I could finish them.
Wow.
You know, I can go five rounds with them. I could hang with anybody in the world. So, you know, I just want to get in there, work my way up to the top 10, and, you know, make a splash.
Hey, man, listen, I want to thank you for coming on the show. It was you came on last minute, man. You were very accommodating, and I really appreciate that. You know, it's good for the show. I really enjoyed it, enjoyed the conversation. And I can't wait to see this fight, man. I can't wait to see how this goes down. It's definitely got my attention. So thank you so much for coming on the show, Steven, and I really appreciate it, man.
Hey, I appreciate you having me on and all the publicity, man. It's all great, and I'd love to do it again.
All right, cool, man. Hopefully we can have you on again in a little bit after the fight or something. That'd be great.
All right, brother. Sounds like a plan.
All right. Talk to you then, bud. Have a great night.
All right. Appreciate it. Right. Bye.
Well, that was Steven Peterson, and he sure had an opinion about Delonte Perry, and I can't wait to see that fight. Apparently it's a done deal. It's going to happen. We're just waiting on a date. We're waiting on some contracts to get signed, and hopefully we get to see that sooner than later. This is it for the Fight House, Episode 2. I want to thank everybody for joining. Enjoy your night, and tune in next week. We're going to have some more guests, some good conversation. It's going to be good. Thanks a lot. Have a good night.